contents of this program are brought to you by Apple Computer, makers of the new Apple IIc, a technological breakthrough of incredible proportions. And by Ford Motor Company. You're going to love the quality. At Ford, quality is job one.
This evening, in a televised address, President Reagan told the nation that his policies in Central America must be continued. If not, he said, the United States faces a threat that is at our doorstep. But right now, there are people who have already crossed the threshold of our country. Hundreds of thousands of Salvadorans have come seeking a safe haven in the United States. Are they political refugees, or are they illegal aliens? Well, joining me now from Harlingen, Texas, KGBT-TV, is Ms. Stacy Merk. She's an American who has been brought to trial for aiding an illegal alien. Ms. Merk, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Your trial in Brownsville, Texas, ended today. Could you tell me why you were arrested?
I was arrested and charged with conspiring to transport and transporting two, quote, illegal aliens.
How long were you involved in this kind of thing?
I came down specifically to Southern Texas to learn more about refugees and to experience more about refugees here in this area. I came to work at Casa Oscar Romero, which is a shelter for Central American refugees.
Tell me what's happening in the south part of Texas as far as the sanctuary movement is concerned. What is the sanctuary movement?
The sanctuary movement itself encompasses over 100 churches of various denominations that have taken a public stance to say that they are going to offer sanctuary, offer refuge to folks from Central America. They're going to give them a place, a forum from which to speak in exchange for protection. And there's certainly the hope that this will help encourage Reagan's policies to change regarding Central America.
Well, now, going back to the fact that you said you still don't think you did anything illegal, when I asked you, did you have any reason to be surprised when you were arrested, you said that, had you known it was illegal, would you have still participated in your desire to help other people?
I think there are two things we're dealing with there. Certainly, number one is my belief in God's laws that I am called to shelter the homeless, to feed the hungry, and to welcome the stranger. Certainly there is that. The second thing that I'm dealing with there and that we're dealing with is the fact that I believe the laws of the United States offer political asylum to persons here. Specifically in the 1980 Refugee Act, these folks are allowed the right to be here to apply for political asylum status. So I think we're talking about two levels here. Number one, a government level, which I believe I'm not guilty of anything there, and number two, God's level, which I know I'm not guilty of, disobeying his laws.
Did you plead not guilty?
I pled innocent. Yep. I went to Tucson a couple weeks ago for a Freedom Seder where 142 persons, church persons, signed a statement saying that they were legally, because of the laws, the 1980 Refugee Act, they were legally transporting Salvadoran refugees to this Freedom Seder, to this Freedom Supper. The church is supportive. The church is strong, and the church is coming out stronger.
From Harlingen, Texas, is Ms. Brenda Sanchez-Golan. She's a Salvadoran seeking refuge in this country. With her is Mr. Jack Elder. He's the director of Casa Oscar Romero, a refuge center for Central Americans, and Mr. Elder will be her interpreter. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. Ms. Golan, could you tell us what prompted you to leave El Salvador?
¿Qué fue el motivo por tu salida?
Bueno, pues, más que todo, el motivo por el cual yo salí de El Salvador es para buscar un refugio para mi familia.
Above all, the reason I left El Salvador was to look for a refuge or a place of safety for my family.
Pues, ya que en El Salvador, por las circunstancias que se están dando, pues, nuestro país está en guerra.
Actually, in El Salvador, we have a state of war, and for those circumstances, I was unable to stay.
Now, you said you wanted to protect your family and there's a state of war and you couldn't stay. Was there any specific incident, single incident, that made you decide to leave?
Has dicho que hay un estado de guerra, que quieres proteger tu familia, pero no ha habido una cosa específica. In my country of El Salvador, a certain group exists whose aim it is to destroy or undermine the projects of those of us who are working with the refugees and church-related projects.
And you specifically felt that your life was in danger and therefore you had to leave?
¿Y tú personalmente te sentías algún peligro I would say yes, because I was one of those persons who was involved in a church-related project working with refugees who were leaving the war zones.
How did you leave El Salvador?
¿Cómo saliste de tu país?
Pues, no sé hasta qué punto, pues...
Pues siempre protegiendo los contactos, pero ¿en qué forma? ¿En autobús,
bueno, pues,
en avión?
Sí salí por avión, pero la cuestión es de que siempre ayudada por las mismas iglesias, siempre protegida por las iglesias.
As I left El Salvador by plane, but at each step of the way I was protected by people related to the church.
Programas de ayuda social.
I didn't come alone, I came with a group of co-workers who were working in the same church-related project with refugees.
And what of your family?
¿Y de tu familia?
De mi familia solamente salimos mi hija, el papá de ella y yo.
Okay, of my family,
the father of my child, myself, and my child were the three who left.
And you left other family behind.
¿Has dejado algunos familiares ahí atrás?
Sí, ha quedado, pues la mayor parte de mi familia, pues ha quedado allá y hasta la fecha yo temo por ellos.
Yes, the majority of the greater number of my family members have remained behind, and that causes me some concern.
So the churches helped you. Was there an underground network that you had heard of for the escape that the churches arranged?
¿Qué clase de red o qué clase de gente te ayudaba de la iglesia? ¿Era en forma legal o clandestina o...?
Bueno, pues en El Salvador se puede decir de que todo se hace clandestinamente, por la razón de que si se hace una cosa abiertamente, pues no lo dejan que uno termine.
You might say that in El Salvador everything is done in a clandestine fashion or secretly, because if one was to help the refugees, for example, very openly, then most likely your project would not be allowed to finish.
I'd like to thank you very much, Ms. Golan, for being with us this evening, and also Mr. Elder for translating.
Muchas gracias por tu participación.
We will return in just a few moments after these commercial messages, and we'll be talking with the defense attorney in this case. We'll also be talking with an expert on immigration. We hope that you'll stay with us and join us on the phones. Are these people illegal aliens, or should they be given refuge? We'll be right back. Joining me now from Harlingen, Texas, is Mr. Dan Sheehan. He's an attorney representing Ms. Stacy Merck. And with me here in New York is Mr. Roger Connor. He's the executive director of the Federation for American Immigration Reform. Mr. Connor, you've been able to hear Ms. Merck and you've been able to hear Ms. Golan. Give me your reaction from what you've heard so far in the program.
I think that that this whole debate is going on two different levels, Sandy. There is a group of people who want to challenge the Reagan administration's policies in Central America. And that's one level at which the debate's going on. This trial, the smuggling of individuals into the United States, is obviously a terrific way to dramatize their opposition to the Reagan administration's policies of Central America.
Now, to suggest that the people who are coming here to the United States
from El Salvador are coming here to seek jobs that's preposterous. The fact of the matter is that, as he must know, the United Nations High Commission on Refugees in March of 1981 officially declared all the people in El Salvador to be prima facie refugees, which means that it's more probable than not that they're refugees fleeing from personal persecution.
If you really want to help anyone in that country who's fearful of their lives and who's displaced by war and is fearful of returning back home, it would be to provide supervised safe haven in the surrounding area.
You know that the solution, talking about down there, is to stop sending military equipment and hardware through Reagan into that country. It doesn't solve anything to be setting up these little camps. You know perfectly well that the people are being terrorized by their own government. 51,000 people, citizens, non-combatants, have been massacred by their government down there. This is preposterous to suggest that somehow you're going to be able to protect these people by bringing them off in camps. Who's going to provide the protection for these people? The government down there? Or would you suggest that it's our military people down there? That's preposterous. I don't think you know what you're talking about.
I want to help the people there as opposed to opposing Reagan. If you want to help the people there,
the government,
then what you will be doing is becoming an advocate for secure refugee camps outside El Salvador, outside the zone of the fighting. It's very interesting to me that the guest said the reason she didn't stay in Mexico was not because she, by her account, not because she wanted to come to the United States, but because there was no assistance available to her in a refugee camp in Mexico.
What he's trying to do is he's trying to force them out of this country and force them out of Mexico to make them stay there, because he's maintaining that, in fact, to allow those people to flee is giving evidence to people all across the world of the barbarous nature of the government that they're supporting down there.
Mr. Conner,
well, everybody knows that.
He keeps saying everybody knows things. It's unfortunate that there's not someone from the State Department, for example, here to defend themselves.
This movement is not helping the 500,000 El Salvadorans that are in this country illegally. It's a few hundred or a couple of thousand. It's drama. It makes good media. And if you want to oppose Reagan's policy in Central America, it's a terrific tool. But if you want to help people, if you're concerned about those displaced by the fighting, most of them can't afford the bus trip, let alone a plane trip out of El Salvador. You will be bringing pressure through international channels on the government of Mexico and other surrounding governments and on the United Nations High Commissioner on Refugees to provide safe haven nearby. Because there's a very interesting thing. If there were safe haven nearby, for one thing, as soon as the fighting died down, the people would easily be able to return home.
Now, I don't know where you get this fantasy about these people coming to our country seeking all of our jobs around here, other than the fact that it seems to be politically palatable for you to say that, and not to talk about what's causing the people to flee down there, really, that everybody knows. The Catholic Church knows that, the United Nations knows that, Amnesty International knows that. I mean, I don't know exactly where your interest comes from in advocating some fantasy that we set up just secure camps down there. Who do you plan to have guard those camps down there? Do you want to send in United Nations troops? Do you want to send in American troops? Do you want to send in Mexican troops? Who's going to guard those camps from their government?
You don't listen to me. I didn't.
Yes, I do.
I said
who's
outside El Salvador.
Where?
Outside in southern Mexico, for example.
In southern Mexico.
You see that there's one little fact that you're ignoring in all this.
Well, what's
and
that,
that
one
is
little fact?
That the great majority of El Salvadorans who are in the United States illegally came here before the fighting ever started. And illegal immigration into the United States from El Salvador for the last 20 years.
Oh, so that you're talking about a 20-year problem? I think all the American audience knows that the problem that's being talked about is the influx of people since about 1976 in the last handful of years. And that's fighting
not the
and
only problem I'm talking. No, I don't agree with that. That's not a correct statement.
So if you're saying it's a problem since before 1976 for 20 years?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, then 20 years ago, it might have been okay to set up some kind of haven for the people down there. The fact of the matter is now that since 1976, the right wing under Dubuisson and Ordain and all of the others that have been verified uniformly by all of the investigating teams that have been sent down there, except by Mr. Reagan and Mr. Kissinger, have verified that the people are being systematically exterminated down there. You cannot set up safe havens for them. The United States
not in El Salvador,
has put up such pressure on
them. You certainly can set up safe haven for them in southern Mexico with the support of the Mexican government.
My comment? That the fact of the matter, is the United Nations High Commission now, whom we have spoken with, and you may not have spoken with in Mexico, says that they have been interviewing Salvadorian refugees who have been coming into Mexico, and that they find that well over 55% of all of those people qualify under the United Nations definition of refugees as fleeing for fear of persecution.
So why then isn't the Mexican government providing them refuge?
The Mexican government is
giving only 1.5%. And why are you pressuring the Mexican government as much as the U.S. government?
Because I live in America. I live in the United States. I vote in the United States. I am responsible for what the United States government is doing down there. I'm not a Mexican. I don't vote in Mexico. It's clear that you go down and they'll say, deal with your own government. Deal with them. This is where I, as a voter, have an effect.
But with the sanctuary movement.
Pardon?
With the sanctuary movement, it is a movement that can concentrate its efforts wherever it chooses.
The sanctuary movement is made up of American citizens who can focus on our government policy. It's the old story, Sandy. If a doctor sits in an office and people keep coming into his office with broken legs, he can either treat the broken legs or he can go out and try to find out that there's a major pothole in the street in front of his house and they're all falling in and getting a broken leg. The fact of the matter is that just tonight, President Reagan came on and told the American people that we need military expenditures to go down and crush the citizenry down there who oppose those people in power. Now, that's no solution. I thought we learned that in Vietnam. I thought we had learned that type of thing. But the fact is that they're functioning on this fantasy of ignoring what's the source of the problem down there.
He wants to argue Central American policy. That's fine. Reagan spoke tonight.
And we really should stick to immigration.
But if we want to talk about immigration, it's got to be put in context, because we cannot have a policy for El Salvador that we're not also going to apply to South Korea, to Taiwan, to the Philippines, to Mexico, to Haiti,
to the entire Caribbean and so on. You see, unfortunately, the world in which we live is one with 4.5 billion people. There are going to be 6 billion people by the year 2000. In Latin America alone, the labor force is going to grow by 80 million people in the next 17 years. So the United States cannot, it is not a solution to offer to say that everyone who is in a country that this gentleman feels is a bad government, is a repressive government, is a right-wing or a left-wing.
Just let me finish. Killed by their people, by their government.
One moment, Mr. Sheehan.
That in every country in the world where this is going on, that the solution is for everyone who can get out to come to the United States. That's not a solution.
All right, we have to stop right here and take a commercial message, but it gets down to the argument of, are we a country that has our arms open to everyone for refuge, as the country was started? Or the other question, though, Mr. Sheehan, that I have to pose to you, how much can this country hold? So there are two very important points going on here, opposite points of view. We'll continue this conversation as soon as we return, and we'll be getting to your phone calls as well.
Yes. I agree with Mr. Connor that we have focused attention in the wrong place on this issue, that we're talking about what's happening in El Salvador rather than what's happening on our borders in relation to the immigration laws of our country. And Mr. Sheehan seems to reinforce this.
Excuse me, I have to ask you to get to your question. Can you get to
my comment is directed toward the young woman who has been charged with aiding an illegal alien to come into the country.
Yes.
I understand her compassion, and I understand why she did what she did, and I hope she doesn't have to serve 15 years in prison or even 15 minutes. But that's not because I believe she's not guilty. I believe that she has exercised compassion without wisdom, which is something that was done also at the Mariel boat lift with the people coming from Cuba. That was a disaster. And
I'm running out of time, and I want to allow Ms. Merck a chance to respond to your comment. Ms. Merck?
My first response is to think back to the Jewish times and the German times when we were fighting World War. And I have a friend that had a good comment: as Jews were being taken away and gassed and killed by the hundreds and by the thousands, that she didn't want to stand by and be a good German and allow that to happen. And I can't stand by and allow that to happen here too. Our Central American policies are very important. The bullets that we send down to Central America, specifically to El Salvador, are the ones that are causing these refugees to come up here. So it seems very clear to me that I'm exercising wisdom and compassion both.
Line one, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. Sandy, I would like to know, why are the immigration policies so changed from Second World War? I mean, at that time, the DPs, and I'm one from Estonia, had to flee from communist terror. We had to go through 20 years of waiting on a quota system. We had to produce health certificates, police certificates, and either a job or a bank account so we wouldn't be a burden on the country. And now all of a sudden, the floodgates are open and we have to support all the illegal aliens.
All right, thanks for your question. I mean, this brings up another point. In World War II, a lot of Jews had to go to South America because they could not get into this country. They weren't able to get papers to come into this country for refuge.
Sandy, the caller just a moment ago made the point that immigration overall is out of control today. Legal immigration and illegal immigration are all out of control. And one of the objectives that we have is, if we have an immigration policy that is under control, then it is possible to deal with situations where you need to bring a group of people into this country in order to save their lives, and priority can be given to the true political refugees. But, you know, a house has a door so that you can open it and allow people to come in. And a country has a border that it controls so that the country, through its democratic institutions, can determine its immigration policy. And we can't have an immigration policy that is determined by the employers who want cheap labor, nor can we have an immigration policy that's determined by individuals who will choose to take the law into their own hands. If we do that and continue it, it will provoke a reaction from the American people that I fear could end up throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
We have to take this last time out. We'll be back right after these words. I want to thank my guest in Harlingen, Texas, Ms. Stacy Merck. She was brought to trial for transporting an illegal alien from El Salvador, and most likely the verdict will be in on that case tomorrow. Thank you very much for being with us this evening, Ms. Merck. And then let me come here to New York and thank Mr. Robert Connor. Mr. Connor is the executive director of the Federation for American Immigration Reform. Thanks for joining us this evening. And once again, back to Harlingen, Texas, to thank Mr. Dan Sheehan. Mr. Sheehan is the attorney representing Stacy Merck. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Sandy.
And thank you for joining us as well. We'll see you on the next program. Good night.